Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight series, The Evolution of Pay. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speaker and periodically jumping in to review some polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. As a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to all four polling questions that we have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have another slide at the end to serve as instruction on how to access certification. And lastly, before I introduce today's speaker, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we are discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speaker, George Mavranza. George serves as Vice President of Strategy and Thought Leadership for Global Cash Card, an ADP company. He brings more than two decades of experience in the prepaid card industry and in executive management, business development, project management, customer service, implementation, and relationship and account management. With that, George, I know you have a lot you'd like to talk about today, so I'm going to turn the event over to you.
Thank you, Karen, for that introduction, and thank you to everyone that took the time out of their day to attend today's webinar. My name is George Mavranzas, and yes, that's a big fat Greek last name. So if you want an easier way to pronounce it, just say my friend's ass three times real fast, and it'll come out to Mavranzas. And you're probably doing that right now in front of your terminal. Before we get started, let me spend a few seconds discussing the value of the ADP Research Institute. It was launched in 2012. It's a valuable resource, the core behind the research we're sharing with you today. And it leverages ADP's empirical data to conduct research that provides transparency into the labor market and eliminates crucial employment and workforce management trends. All research findings are available as a public good. Things that you might know, ADP pays one in six workers in the U.S., and we serve more than almost a quarter of a million clients globally. The ADP National Employment Report provides a count of the monthly employment growth based on real transactional payroll data. And the ADP Workforce Vitality Report is a quarterly measure that looks at the dynamics and key market indicators beyond employment growth, such as wage growth, hours worked, and turnover rate. Finally, we look at other workforce issues, including pay equity, talent management, and compliance issues. So very excited about the value that the ADPRI brings to the table today. Perfect. A year ago, ADP delved into generational trends shaping the future of worker pay and explored how Gen Z, millennials, Gen X, baby boomers, and traditionalists differ when it came to their outlooks and expectations for their careers and how they viewed pay as a part of their work experience. I spent more than a year on the road delivering that research to APA local chapters, statewide conferences, HR, Treasury, and a variety of industry events. The latest research from the ADP Research Institute, conducted just in July of 2018, went deeper into the role of pay, which was summarized in a report called Timely Insights into the Evolution of Pay and Talent Management. And that's what I'm here to talk to you about today. The goal is to assess the role of pay in talent management and explore perceptions of traditional and emerging pay methods from both the employee and employer perspective. Items such as sentiments about pay, the most important aspects from both the employer and the employer side, commonalities and differences among different groups and demographics, including the disconnects between employers and employees when it comes to pay, and finally, a huge topic in today's arena, employee financial wellness. Employers have reasons to care about employee financial wellness, and they can play a trusted role in offering support. So in this presentation, we'll cover driving forces changing the world of work and pay. We'll spend a few seconds looking at the survey demographics and methodology, key elements of pay, diverse workers and pay priorities, both the employer and employee perspectives. We'll talk about financial wellness and performance, and then we'll look at the research conclusions, and if time permits, we'll go into some Q&A. So driving forces changing the world of working pay. Let's move to the next slide. Thank you. So before we dig into the details, let's talk about the evolving landscape when it comes to the challenges and opportunities available to employers and employees today. First and foremost, we need to acknowledge that in the era of record low unemployment, competition for talent among companies is fierce. Any competitive edge an organization can gain during the recruitment process has value. That said, the next key to ongoing performance and success is to retain and develop that talent. And as we'll discuss today, how an employer contributes to the financial wellness of their employees above and beyond compensation can make a huge difference. But beyond increased competition for talent, companies also have to deal with major shifts in values, priorities and behaviors of their employees. In that context, companies fail to adapt to the values and priorities of millennials and Generation Z will lose those employees to more modern companies that deliver incentives and benefits that reflect their values. At the same time, as you know, the world of work itself is changing. We talk about this gig economy, which places a premium on flexibility and work on demand, creates challenges for how companies manage their talent. ADP research shows that by 2020, 40% of the U.S. work population will be 1099 independent contractors, freelancers. Finally, technology and consumer behaviors trends impact how employees view and value pay. The fact that bank accounts and paper checks are quickly becoming a relic of another age is just one example of how some basic assumptions on how we pay employees needs to reflect how they make purchases, manage their finances as consumers. In fact, we'll see many younger generation workers don't have a bank account and likely will never have written a paper check in their lives. And it really comes down to when you enter the workforce as a generation. My father, as a traditionalist, came in at a time where they were still paying wages in cash or a paper check. Baby boomers hold of direct deposit in high numbers. And then as you come into these younger generations, they may not want a traditional financial institution relationship. Not that they couldn't get a bank account, but they choose not to. So in short, when you look at the evolution of work in our workforce, we can see nothing is sacred. Change is constant, so is competition, and nothing can be assumed. Everything is being re-examined. And as the ADP Research Institute's results show us, the same holds true for the evolution of pay. So we see record employment rates, The priorities are shifting, a dynamic shift in workforce composition. First time in history, we have five generations working at the same time to refresh traditionalists, baby boomers. More baby boomers are retiring every day than any other generation. Generation X, which is my generation, millennials, and of course, Gen Z. As the world of work and pay are changing, next generation workers, the younger ones have different demands. We're seeing new non-traditional payment technologies emerge, things like Zelle, Venmo, electronic wallets like Google Pay, Apple Pay, Samsung Pay. And the gig economy presents new challenges for employers and 1099 workers, really putting the emphasis on us to be prepared on how we are going to react and manage the diverse W-2 1099 population, the various demographics and generations within our individual companies. So let's take a quick look at the study goals and methodologies for the research. Next slide, please.
You should be seeing it, George. Do you see it?
I don't, but I can go forward. The survey was conducted among 500 employers and 1,000 mostly W-2 employees, that companies with 50 or more employees. In addition, we looked at 896 contract 1099 freelance workers with no restrictions on company size. The online interviews were conducted in July of 2018, so the research is really fresh, not even a year old. And it aimed to reveal perceptions of traditional and emerging payment methods among employers and employees. The employee results were aggregated and analyzed by generation, and perceptions around how pay is delivered, whether it be direct deposit, check, pay card, when it's delivered, same day, early access were examined as well. Next slide. One of the things that bubbled up from our research was the priorities and values that workers place on certain aspects of pay. When asked about their priorities related to pay, here's what workers and employers told us. And that takes us to our first polling question, Karen.
Yes, thank you so much, George. So at this point, you should be seeing the first polling question on the screen. And our first question is, what is your highest priority when it comes to pay? Your options are, is it speed? Is it security? Or is it flexibility? I'm going to give you all about 30 seconds to respond, and I'm going to give my first CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. I'm going to give you all several more seconds. Okay, George, you should see the results on the screen. Can you see them okay?
Not yet, just waiting for it to update on my side.
Here, well, I can read them to you if you like. Security was their top one at 64%. And then their second choice was flexibility at about 20%, and speed was the last thing at 16%.
Wow, they just popped up. Yes, I do see that. Great. And you know what? It really ties in if you go into the next slide. From a security perspective, Karen, that is right on with the research. As we suggested earlier, security, speed, and flexibility reflected the top three priorities for all survey respondents. However, security ranked as a top priority for all workers, with 60% of all respondents indicating that it was an important feature of pay. So in many ways, security comes ahead of all other considerations. As a matter of fact, in my previous life at Global Cash Card, we used to say all the time, security, security, security. And in this age and what we hear in the media about breaches and, you know, critical breaches to our most critical information, we can understand why security is at the top of the list. Now, the demand for flexibility produced all kinds of interesting results. 50% or more of millennials and Gen X employees would accept non-traditional payment methods from their employer today. 78% of on-demand workers say the same. So as we kind of look, even though security was the most prevalent of the options, speed and flexibility when it came to off-cycle payments, ability to choose frequency, even paying a small fee for early access to pay were all high considerations as well. Finally, 60% of employees said the ability to select pay frequency, same-day pay, early access to pay, or pay cards would make a difference in whether or not they accepted a job. And this is also a generational shift, Karen, where originally, from a traditionalist or a baby boomer perspective, they would spend 20 years, 30 years at a job and not necessarily love it. In fact, we spoke to people that didn't like it at all. And as a Generation Xer, we would just be totally enthralled if we could find that job security, if we could find a job that we could spend that much time at. Well, what's drastically changed with our millennials and Generation Z is that they're really trying to align themselves with an organization that has the same value set as they do. So, for example, they're offered a job and they would come back and say, you know what, I'll take less annual compensation, more vacation time, and I'd like to work 2 days out of the house. And guess what? They're getting it in many cases because the war on talent is so fierce right now that it's hard to keep and retain talent. So they're really, you know, the shift is changing based on what they're demanding. So again, when you look at the numbers, security comes first. But in aggregate, the speed and choice were just as important. So let's move on. One other dimension to the survey which bears mentioning is the value that employers and employees place on financial wellness as a dimension of pay. In 2015, the CFPB, which is the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, published a report focusing on financial well-being, and they define it as, quote, a state of being wherein you have the financial freedom to make the choices that allow you to enjoy life, end quote. And it's a broad topic, right? But some of the main considerations are the control over day-to-day, month-to-month finances, the capacity to absorb a financial shock, which is important. Because when we talk about the absorption of a financial shock, we found it just took one mishap, one $400 car repair, one medical emergency, or one childcare issue that could throw an employee's life into financial chaos. And we'll make some of the correlation a little bit later in the webinar, where if an employee is suffering financial stress at home, they may not be, or we know for a fact they're not producing or not performing at an employee level at their highest levels because of that financial stress at home. Are they on track to meet financial goals and obtain financial freedom to make the choices that allow you to enjoy life? So it could be budgeting, could be spending, savings wallet, income, debt reduction, all these things incorporate financial wellness. Perfect. As this relates to employers and pay, providing employees with tools to gain better visibility and management of their pay, like I previously said, budgeting, spending habits, debt management, savings goals, and income goals can contribute significantly to the financial wellness of their employees. And employees told us that they would value this kind of contribution to their financial well-being from their employers. I had the pleasure of delivering this research on a panel with Dr. Martin Armstrong from Charter Communications this week, and tuition reimbursement plays a critical role in fostering financial wellness and some of the respondents he spoke to within his organization, that they would actually consider that and have considered that as a differentiator when they selected a job. as the slide indicates, high numbers, 95% of employers say employee financial wellness impacts their company, and almost two-thirds of employees want to work for a company that cares about their financial wellness. So, as we move on to the next slide, at a high level, we can see that much like other aspects of our lives, employees want more choices, more flexibility, the ability to access their pay as needed, and above all, security. Digging a layer deeper, when we look at employees from a few different dimensions, we see different priorities begin to emerge. So, profiles and perspectives. Rather than just looking at generational trends, the ADP Research Institute looked at the data through a number of different lenses, including income levels, and also factors like whether or not an employee had children in the household. And here's what we found when examining each of these groups in terms of pay priorities and financial wellness perspectives. And we looked at millennials and next-gen Gen Z workers. We looked at gig economy, those 1099 independent contractors, high-income workers, hourly wage employees, and we also looked at parents. So millennials, for example, like next-gen employers, or Gen Z employees, rather, prioritize speed more than their older counterparts. Fewer millennials have bank accounts or use credit cards. And the younger the generation, the less likely they are to rely on them. This is consistent with an overall trend we saw, where only half of the survey respondents said they would keep a traditional bank account if it wasn't needed to receive pay from an employer. And not surprisingly, off-cycle pay options had value to them. So we look at speed, and let's kind of put that into context. Look at today's environment. The consumerization of payments and our addiction to the convenience and speed aspect. We pay tolls today going 70 miles per hour. We have apps on our phone to buy our coffee with, you know, venti, sour, no soy, no whips, two Splenda, and pick it up and already had paid for it and bypassing the line. We have apps that have groceries delivered straight to our home. You can get an Uber and pay for your ride, and if your friend, you can split the fare with your friend who's sharing the ride, and if your friend forgot their wallet or phone, they can Venmo you the money later. There's no more waiting in line, and if someone disrupts that digital flow, well, you hear about it. Like, what is this guy doing, pulling out cash? Or God forbid you pull out a check at Walmart or Target. So when we look at mobile and digital, we look at millennials as being tech dependent, and we learned that from last year's research in generational trends shaping the future of worker pay. They're tech dependent because they rely on the technology. It's plug and play. It goes back to that old invention versus innovation argument, right? The invention is who invented the first cell phone, and many of you remember it. It was the size of a VCR, for those of you who remember what a VCR is, and it was probably emitting a lot of plutonium back in those days. But innovation is what we have today. The iPhones and all the latest technology where all your financial data and apps are integrated within your phone. And that's making an existing invention better. So invention versus innovation. And Gen Z is tech savvy. They're truly the first mobile-only generation. So we talk about millennials in terms of you know, less likely than older workers to use bank accounts or credit cards. That's a generational thing, too. My father was a traditionalist. At age 13, he got me, a Generation Xer, a checking account at Navy Federal Credit Union, taught me how to balance a checkbook. I have two children, two boys that are Generation Z. I tried the same thing that my father taught me, opened them up checking accounts. But you guess what? That didn't stick with them. They preferred pay cards. And they both have pay cards, and I put money on their accounts so they can use it. I can track it. I can use it as a parenting tool. I can see their transaction history. even if they don't like it. Parents enjoy that to send them off to college in lieu of sending them with their personal credit card and realizing, hey, why Hooters isn't the college bookstore, right? So you see that that generational shift has happened as well. And then as we talk about millennials and this delayed adulthood and generational dislocation, where millennials don't become financially independent, that means that their parents aren't paying their cell phone bill or their car insurance, that they're out of the house paying for all their bills at age 29. And if they're waiting for age 29 to move out and become financially independent, then they're waiting very late to make some major life decisions like getting married or purchasing a home or purchasing any major economic purchase. The data suggests that home ownership among millennials is not guaranteed. So previous generations experienced that unbanked, underbanked, underserved segment because perhaps bad credit, divorce, bankruptcy. Younger generations elect not to have a traditional banking relationship, not because they can't, because they don't want one. One more point. Our previous study, we learned that younger generations found the payroll department was more important than the CEO. So it's a logical step that they're more willing to share information with a payroll provider to get money advice, which is the last bullet on this slide. They consider payroll and retirement plan providers equally trustworthy for financial advice. Again, these are trends that are shifting, where traditionalists and baby boomers and even Generation Xers may have those traditional relationships with financial planners, where the younger generations may look to payroll to get advice. And Karen, I believe that takes us to our second poll question.
Yes, thank you so much, George. So before George shares some insights on our freelancers and 1099 workers, you should be seeing the second question on your screen, and it is, does your organization use contingent workers or freelancers, also called 1099 workers? So your options are yes, we do, no, we don't, or you are unsure. And I'm going to give my second CPE reminder for those of you that want CPE credit to please make sure that you respond to the question to qualify. And I'm going to give you all about 10 more seconds to respond. Okay. So it looks like over 50% of you, 52%, yes, in fact, do use 1099 workers. 45 of you do not, and almost 3% of you are unsure.
Wow. So, yeah, that over 50% number is strong, Karen, and it really behooves payroll departments and organizations as a whole to see what they're doing to really ensure they're retaining those 1099s and have tools in place to allow them to fulfill those needs. And as we move on to the next slide and talk about 1099 workers, as you might appreciate, those gig economy workers are a growing category in the workforce. And their needs and priorities are changing. How employers need to look at pay. And number one, access to pay is a major challenge and priority for this group, where there may or may not even be a fixed cycle to their payment to begin with. Today, for most 1099 workers, which includes both freelancers and on-demand workers, paper checks followed by direct deposits are still the most common method of payment in the past year, with only 22% paid through a digital payment portal, or 13% via mobile payment and only 9% via pay card. From a financial wellness standpoint, this makes sense. Managing taxes and receiving timely payments are their top financial wellness challenges. They struggle, as the slide illustrates, to collect payments in a timely manner. When we talk about talent management and the war to retain talent, as the economy provides more 1099 opportunities, let's say a 1099 freelance worker like a graphic designer is offered one job in, from Florida, another job in New York, similar jobs, but one of the differences is the Florida job can pay in 2 days, while the New York job can pay in net 30. Obviously, the attraction for that gig worker is to take the job that pays in 2 days, and that's a differentiator there. And that's what we're hearing when we talk about speed and access to pay. Also, as part of our previous discussions, Uber drivers can pay a small fee today, a 50-cent fee to get their pay daily versus waiting their normal cycle. And who wouldn't push that 50-cent button to get their pay daily versus waiting? So prioritize reduced steps and costs of use to access pay. Find same-day pay and choice of pay frequency particularly appealing. And financial wellness challenges, managing taxes, that's a clear winner. If they're not making advance payments to the IRS, and who wants to do give their money early to the IRS, right? And timely payment. Next slide. Thank you, Karen. So interestingly, we're looking at high-income workers, and that's 75,000 or more. When you look at high-income workers, their interest in early and off-cycle pay options match those of lower-wage earners. What differs is how they would use those funds. They are just as interested in getting their money as quickly as possible. And they're less likely to use early access for emergencies or unexpected situations. Generally, when they're at that income level, they're generally not as keen to live paycheck to paycheck. They may have a buffer or a savings account that allows them to absorb that financial shock that we were talking about earlier. And this is a group that, like some of the older generations, trust financial advisors and have those traditional retirement planner connections for their financial wellness. Let's move on to hourly workers, Karen. In contrast, hourly workers place less trust in third parties in general and for third-party financial wellness advice as well. Their perspective is definitely more focused on the now, with same-day pay seen as providing greater value when compared to other groups, and the need for early pay focused on more on emergency expenses. So there's more stress on payday for hourly workers. They are getting paid, going through their wages in 2 or 3 days, and then wondering, how am I going to bridge the gap for the next 12, 11 days for the next pay period? They're also more likely to review paycheck details. And when I give this presentation to a live audience, I see a lot of heads nodding because they are reviewing every line by item of their paycheck details, every deduction, everything, net pay, because every penny matters. I did this presentation at HR from an HR event, and a funny story is an employee went into HR indicating, hey, I already have enough deductions, I already have a garnishment, but I didn't authorize this deduction to this young lady named FICA. I don't know who she is, but please stop that because I need my money. So the perspective on reviewing the paycheck details is spot on. I will say hourly workers that make up our younger generations are reviewing their paycheck details from their mobile device. They want to see their pay stub in their hands. They're taking advantage of that technology. Like I said before, they place less trust in financial advisors, retirement plan providers, and they're more likely to say same-day pay would impact their decision to accept a job. The need for their money right now is critical. Let's move on to parents. Thank you, Karen. More stress on payday. Again, interested in early access to pay for emergencies, unexpected expenses. We mentioned three large ones that we talked about, whether it be a car repair, a child care issue, or a medical emergency. Those with kids under 18 have a greater interest in alternative pay options and financial wellness. I mentioned earlier that it really depends when you came into as a generation, when you started earning wages, and what type of vehicle that you used to accept those, whether it be a paper check, direct deposit, or pay cards. I think as parents, we've tried to teach those traditional options. However, we're seeing that the two younger generations are more into the electronic methods, and a lot of times the pay card methods as well, especially for kids going the way of college versus the traditional methods that we discussed earlier, going up with your parents' credit card, something of that nature. Let's transition over to employer and employee perspectives. Let's look at it as distinct groups. From what we've covered so far, you might think that employers and employees see eye to eye when it comes to attitudes and perspectives about pay, but the data shows otherwise. And that takes us to another poll question, Karen.
Yes, thank you so much, George. So at this point, you all should see the third polling question on your screen. And this is a bit of a multiple choice. You can choose more than one option. So the question is, does your organization offer any of the following when it comes to pay? And you can check all that apply to you. So does your organization offer customized pay options? For example, the ability to choose pay frequency. Does your organization offer early access to pay? Does it offer mobile or digital access to pay? Or does it offer none of the above? And I'm going to give my third CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. I'm going to give you all about 10 more seconds. Okay, and looking at the results, customized pay options is less than 1%, so not a lot there. Early access to pay is only 4%. We're a little better with mobile and digital access at 37, but 61% said none of the above for any of those options, George.
Wow, so a lot of opportunity, Karen, especially for the top three categories, but also for mobile digital access to pay, which is just a tremendous demand from our younger generations to have mobile access to not only to their perhaps a pay card account or mobile access to pay stub information. A lot of opportunity for early access to pay for those financial emergencies and financial wellness. So a lot of area here that the research is indicating that's important to employers and employees. So good information. Thank you for that. Perfect. So let's move on to employers and employees having conflicting views. And from our survey results, Karen, here are just a few disconnects that we observed. At a high level, employers underestimate or undervalue the attractiveness of speed and flexibility, when most employees say that it could be a real difference maker when it comes to accepting the job offers. Employers say pay are greater than perks. 67% say pay matters more than pay-related perks. But when you talk to employees, pay options matter. More than half of the employees said pay options would make a significant difference in accepting an offer, which I always go back to the generational trend study that, you know, in my dad's generation as a traditionalist, in a baby boomer's perspective, you know, they were just trying to get a job, whatever job it was. And then as a Generation Xer coming up in that environment, you know, I was forced to get a job, right? And I could only imagine to myself saying to my father at that young age, you know what, Dad, I'm waiting for a different, a better job, something that had more pay options. I would end up ducking to not get hit by a flying sandal or something. So it's very generational here. Customized options. 73% from an employer perspective said that they needed to offer customized pay options to compete. Employees say choice is greater than customization. Employees focus on choices and flexibility. For example, the ability to choose pay frequency, early pay. Early pay, a lot of opportunity there. Pay frequency would be a dynamic change. You know, usually pay frequency is determined by the employer, by the organization. So interesting there, the information coming out of the survey now. Millennials go mobile. Employers say and assume millennials want digital or mobile pay more than Generation Xers. But employees say, remember, they're not ready for mobile. Only 12% of millennials or Gen Xers say they prefer mobile or digital alternative pay. And that's because, remember, Gen Z is the first truly only mobile generation. Remember, millennials are tech dependent. Gen Z are tech savvy. And Generation Xers, like myself, are somewhere in between. We're learning. From the survey, we're not ready for mobile at the same level as the younger generations. Same day is a perk. Employers saw same day as a perk with limited appeal. Karen, from your survey results, we got very low percentage there. Employees, especially those hourly employees, Karen, early access is critical. Over half of the workers would pay for extra pay access for emergencies and unexpected expenses. So we have to look at the dynamic there. You know, how many experience that? How many are living paycheck to paycheck? So that said, speed and flexibility when it comes to things like same-day pay or early access were viewed by employers as a kind of exciting or attractive perk with not that much appeal, while employees saw it as a more of a necessity to deal with these things like emergencies or unexpected expenses. Beyond that, rather than tailored or custom pay solutions for specific target groups, all respondents wanted choice and flexibility. So think about paying more as a toolkit full of options rather than a specific solution for one group or another. So let's move on to paying attitudes about financial wellness. And let's look at another layer deeper into what our survey respondents told us about financial wellness and its role and priority within their work lives. And Karen, I believe that takes us to our last polling question.
Yes, it does. Thank you so much, George. So at this point, you should be seeing the last polling question on your screen. And before George dives into the findings, we just wanted to ask, does your organization offer financial wellness programs? And your options to answer are yes, it does, no, it doesn't, or you are unsure. And I'm going to give my final CPE reminder. For those of you who want credit, to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. I'm going to give you all several more seconds to make sure you have enough time. Okay, so, it's almost evenly split. So we have yes, about 45% do offer financial wellness. No, at a little more, at almost 49% actually don't. And then 6% are unsure.
Really encouraging numbers, Karen, and that's great because, you know, financial wellness covers such a broad range of areas that it's great to see that about half of organizations have something in place. And it also presents a great opportunity for the other half to look at their enterprise and see how they can and maximize some financial wellness tools, especially when we talk about pay and talent management. As we move on to employer attitudes about financial wellness, and this is one area where we see commonalities among employers and employees, right? The employer survey definitely understand and saw the value in financial wellness when it comes to employee performance and talent recruitment and retention. I mean, 95% is a mandate of employers that say employee financial wellness has an impact on their business. They see it in time and attendance. They see it in performance. They see it in tenure and longevity. So crucial number there. And even more than two-thirds, 81% of employers say offering financial wellness tools and solutions would help their company attract top talent. And it goes back to what we mentioned at the beginning of the webinar. Any little thing that differentiates you to attract talent and keep talent. Let's look at the employee attitude now, Karen, about financial wellness. And likewise, employees appreciate the role that their employers could play in their financial wellness, right? 85% indicated financial wellness was important to overall well-being. High number. Less stress with their finances at home means less stress at work. 74% wanted to work for an employer who cares about their financial wellness. We've seen this with our previous studies and generational trends. We see it with today's study where especially our younger generations, they really want to work for companies that not only care about their financial wellness, but also care about their specific value sets. Maybe they're producing a product or servicing an item that is important to the environment or something that's doing something for the common good. They'll take less pay to move over. It's a significant difference. Even if you go back to Generation X, in my previous life, I worked in call centers. And for most people that worked in call centers like me, you're probably still in therapy. But regardless, in those days, an employee would leave you for 25 cents more an hour and a weekend day off. That's what it would take. A quarter and a weekend day off. Now, it's completely different. It's not the compensation. It's, hey, I want to work with a company that cares about my financial wellness. I want a company that cares about what we're doing here when it comes to the planet, or you know, what are we doing to take care of people, or does it really specifically align with my value set? 72% say employers should take an interest in their financial well-being. And then, of course, 73% of younger workers say they would share personal information with a payroll provider to receive money management tips, best practices. This is a change. Even though this is a high number, when I do this to a live audience, this webinar, especially in payroll and HR, they are accustomed to, you know, especially in a payroll environment, we're not allowed to give advice. That was something that I heard over and over again. Now the younger workers are saying, you know what, we want advice. We don't know what to do, and we don't really take advantage of the traditional methods of a financial advisor or someone like that. So some opportunities there when we talk about financial wellness. So what did we learn from the study as a part of these research conclusions? And quite a lot, really. Pay has a deep influence and impact on workers. After talking to these groups about their priorities as it relates to pay and financial wellness, here's some of the key things that we took away. First of all, when it comes to key elements of pay valued by employees and employers alike, security, speed, and flexibility rose to the top, with almost 90% of employees expecting that workers will be paid via non-traditional methods within the next 10 years. These factors should loom large in how employers prioritize and implement new payment solutions. Now, we talk about security, security, security. We also found that from an industry perspective, you can't really meet that through a third-party type of affiliation. We're looking at direct processors, in-house technology to actually control and be able to change quickly for any of the legislation and compliance aspects available, and to ensure that the information and the data is secure at all times. Secondly, pay has a broad impact on how companies recruit, retain, and reward employees. This is something that both employers and employees agree on, and it's true across all categories of employees. Third, pay helps to address the issue companies face when it comes to tapping into the gig economy and attracting and providing incentives to millennials and Gen Z workers. Managing gig economy workers is a challenge and opportunity that will only continue to grow. As we mentioned, as this economy is cyclical, we'll only see more gig jobs become available. At the same time, the generational trends we see today will only accelerate as time goes by. Lastly, as we see from the results, employers and employees share different perspectives and have different priorities when it comes to pay. Getting both parties to see eye to eye is a key to ongoing success. Next, secure, fast, and flexible pay choices have a broad appeal. So, what opportunities are there for employers to tap into these trends and insights? Here are a few suggestions that are born out of our study. Younger generations want access to their pay stub, pay details on their mobile device. We know that. And as you know, if we look at our poll question data, we have opportunity there for sure. As a matter of fact, as the first true mobile-only generation, they have fostered this technology demand for these non-traditional payment methods like Zelle, Venmo, electronic wallets, like I mentioned before, Apple Pay, Samsung Pay, Google Pay. Early access to pay is attracted to hourly 1099 high-wage earners. They want their money now. And again, employers and employees both agree that promoting financial wellness can boost performance and attract talent and also retain talent, which is critical. With that being said, I'm going to turn it back over to Karen for some ending remarks. Karen?
Thank you so much, George, for all that interesting, all those interesting insights from the research. A lot of for employers to think about. There's just a couple questions, if that's okay. I'd like to lobby at you. Someone had asked, at some point you said that millennials and Gen Z aren't really keeping money in the bank, in traditional bank accounts as much anymore. So someone's asking, so where are they putting their money if they're not in a bank account?
Right. Good question. A lot of millennials and the younger generations are keeping their funds on a pay card or some type of digital wallet. And then many are still using cash. We're still seeing a lot of paper checks being produced for millennial and Gen Z workers too. So they're not really in love with a branch location at a bank. They're not the type of generation that wants to wake up on their day off and pick up a paper check and cash it. So we do see some paper checks, but a lot of times they're going to pay cards, and many times they're using a lot of those digital wallet options out there, like we mentioned before.
Okay, that makes sense. Okay, so we have another question here about what's an example of a customized pay option?
Well, customized pay options are really just the choices. Like you can customize your pay options to go from the traditional electronic direct deposit, pay cards, paper check. A lot of you have one. Maybe you're all direct deposit if you're able to go 100% direct deposit. Others may just have direct deposit or pay card, and then because of compliance, some of you have all three. The customization is, are you having alternate pay methods and options for those 1099 gig workers? What are you doing with your pension plans? If you're in higher education, do you have payment options for perhaps students? Disbursements. So there's so many other things that we're finding when we're talking to people out in the field that it's beyond normal wages. You're having employees in large segments retire in big numbers, and you're producing a lot of checks to take care of that segment. Where why wouldn't you go all electronic? So having customized payment options for your demographics, it's not just W-2 anymore. You have to look at it across the whole board.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. So, all right, so I have another, it's kind of a two-parter, and I don't know if you had any insight in the research here, but it's why are higher income workers likely to want early pay options? What is the theory behind this trend in the data?
Well, that's a behavioral trend, and we see that because it's just that need and convenience to get their money now. I want it now. It's the same reason why you see hundreds of people line up outside Best Buy when a new piece of technology is released. They want to be the first ones to get it, and they want their money right away. And it, and we see that access to funds no different from that. They want to have their money now. So high-income workers, a lot of times from a payroll perspective, when I talk to payroll professionals, they're always contacting payroll saying, you know, where's my money, or, you know, how can I get it quicker as well?
Okay. That makes sense. All right, I'm going to do one more for you, I think, before we hit the top of the hour. So for the last question is, do states address the fees for 1099 employees like they do for pay cards?
So different compliance aspects of it. So W-2 pay card has very strict regulations that are ever-changing state by state. For 1099, there are regulations, but it's not as rigid as W-2. So I would encourage you, when you do your evaluation, to ask your provider, whoever you're talking to discuss that. And as we discussed at the beginning of the webinar, always check with your internal counsel as well.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, George, for all those insights and for answering those questions from our audience.
My pleasure.
So based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email. And if you requested CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. To receive ongoing communications from ADP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines, please subscribe to our IM Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. For more workforce trends and insights, we encourage you to visit our ADP blog link shown on the screen. And we also encourage you to register for additional Workplace Spotlight webinars using the link in the resource area. On behalf of George, myself, and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today. I look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you and have a great day.